With the 200th anniversary of the founding of the Lawrenceville School, we thought it a good time to explore the rich history surrounding this institution. However, our interests lay beyond these time-worn grounds and rest in the history of this great nation, and the parts Lawrenceville has played in shaping that history over the last two centuries. And so today, we celebrate those brave Lawrentians who served during the Second World War. We reflect on those tremendous sacrifices they made overseas, and the sacrifices made by their families here on the home front. When war broke out in Europe in September of 1939, there was one undisputed king of the sky, the Luftwaffe, Nazi Germany's relentless air force. Technologically advanced and vastly superior in numbers, the rest of the world was forced to watch in awe and terror as this aerial armada ravaged Europe's countryside. At least until the United States of America knew it was time to take action.
Despite the country's official non-aggression policy, President Roosevelt ordered a profound increase in U.S. military forces, specifically an expansion of the nation's outdated Air Corps. Roosevelt knew we could only defeat the tyrannical Nazi regime by controlling the skies, and, as the technologically superior Luftwaffe dominated the European arena, the U.S. would need to effectively combat this potent force. To accomplish this ambitious task, the United States would need to increase aircraft productivity tenfold. However, the American people were up to the challenge, and everyone pitched in to take our outdated World War I airplanes into the new era. Within months, the United States was producing more planes per month than the Nazis had in operation at the onset of the war.
Well, here's my mom. We're going to get you in on this. She was a Rosie the Riveter, and why don't you tell about you and your sisters who did that when their summer breaks from college, I guess.
Well, we did. The war was waiting for us, and we got out there, and I don't even remember.
Well, you worked on the aircraft?
Yeah. Worked with a lot of people. Everybody had something to do, and we had a long day, that's for sure, and 6 days a week. Most of the time.
While Roosevelt sought to bring the American military up to par with the European powers, in Wilmington, Delaware, one Charles A. Higgins, Jr. was preparing to attend Lawrenceville Prep School in central New Jersey. By attending such a reputable boarding school, Charles hoped to prepare for the Yale University entrance exam. Immediately upon his arrival, Charles became an active leader on campus, being elected president of the photography club his first year. While just a hobby in high school, Charles's prominence with photography would prove more valuable than even he could have expected. For even though, after graduation, he gained admission to Yale's class of 1944, Charles would only spend 2 years at the civilian institution before enrolling in officer candidate school at Fort Monmouth, New Jersey. Despite the rigorous regiment of high-altitude training, Charles managed to endure the experience and earn commission as a Signal Corps officer.
Dear Mr. Healy, after having been at Fort Monmouth for 6 months, I am just beginning to make an effort in the direction of Officer Candidate School, just as the quota has been slashed to some 14% of its former self. Could I impose upon you to the extent of a letter of recommendation? If, on the other hand, you feel that one would not be justified in view of my rather disappointing scholastic record at Lawrenceville, please by all means do so. The letter should be addressed to whom it may concern, and sent to me at the training regiment, Fort Monmouth, New Jersey. With many thanks for anything you may be able to do, and my best regards to Mrs. Healy. Sincerely, Charlie Higgins.
With this recommendation in hand, Charles went on to become an aerial photographer in the Allied Air Force, until his plane was shot down in March of 1945 and Charles Higgins was declared missing in action.
Over the course of the war, Mrs. Higgins and the wife of Alan Healy, headmaster of the Lawrenceville School from 1934 to 1959, maintained a series of correspondence. Upon receiving word of Charles's status as missing in action, Mrs. Higgins immediately sought comfort in her friend, Mrs. Healy. What followed was an exchange of reassurances of Charles's safety. However, hopes of her son's eventual return were shattered on May 16th by a letter from one of Charles's superior officers, Corporal Harris. Harris presented Mrs. Healy with the same story as told to him by Edward Gardner of the events that transpired that day. First, apologizing for the security regulations that prevented conveying the information earlier, and ending on a warmer note.
It was a tough break. I had grown very fond of him. He was one of the best officers I have ever known, and a real pal of all of us. I really admired him.
To help cope with her loss, Mrs. Higgins arranged a trip to Lawrenceville from her home in Wilmington, Delaware. In her follow-up letters, she claims that seeing Mrs. Healy and the teachers Charles knew best at Lawrenceville helped a great deal in dealing with the death of her son. Yet, a month later, she reveals a more contradictory mindset. The final letter Mrs. Healy received from Charles's mother was short and filled with sadness.
I'm going to Maine with a friend of mine to spend some quiet time on a small island.
Although Mrs. Higgins expressed intentions to continue writing to Mrs. Healy from Maine, no other letters arrived. Unfortunately, cases like these were not uncommon during the war. The loss of a loved one is always difficult, but the loss of a child is unbearable.
I'm the class, actually, I graduated in the fall of 43. There were about 16 of us. I was abducted the day before I graduated, okay? The reason I ended up in the Army was, at the end of the line, these guys know, there was a guy from the Navy, Army, and Air, and there was no Air Force in those days. What was the other one?
Marines.
The what? The Marines. Marines, the Marines. So I asked the Marines, I said, when do I have to report? He said, tomorrow. I said, I asked the Navy guy, I said, you got a week. And then the Army guy said, 3 weeks. Sold. So that's how I ended up in the Army. My first job after the war, went to college. My first job was here. I taught Spanish here for a year. I was in Raven House.
My name's Bob Dalzell. The USS Dixie, AD-14, a destroyer tender with 1,200 in crew. We could do anything. I came back here and met with Dr. Tostevin, who used to be head of admissions, and he said, why don't you go someplace and get a GED? And I said, Dr. Tostevin, for those 3 years I was out fighting for the country, what I kept thinking about was coming back to Lawrenceville. And he wiped away a tear or two when I got admitted and surprised everybody, including myself, by making the honor roll. But when, at the end of the year, they gave me a wartime, what was that called?
Honoris Causa.
Honoris Causa. And they said, if you finish college, we'll give you a full diploma. So 5 years ago, I got my diploma signed by Liz Duffy.
And they sent me to Fort Riley, Kansas. And we were supposed to change aerial photos and change maps on the ground. So when the Air Force disturbed the topography, we were supposed to show everybody what the changes were. And we shipped out for Europe, and we landed after the Battle of the Bulge in January of 45, and got to the Remagen Bridge, and then decided the war was over in May of 45 in Europe. So those of us who hadn't been in Europe very long were now sent to the Pacific for the invasion of Japan, which was scheduled for November of 45, and we got on a ship in Marseille, went across the Pacific, and they dropped the bomb, and we proceeded to the Philippines, and we were very happy that the bomb was dropped, not for the recipients, but for the million or so casualties that were coming from the U.S. of A., and anyway, so came back, went to the University of Pennsylvania, and that's about it. I'm like Fred Berg, though. I was a PFC a long time before they made me a corporal. And he came out as a staff sergeant, and I came out as a corporal. Anyway, long time coming. And Lawrenceville was a great preparation for the service.
There was obviously a lot that affected the home front, or Americans in the war, and what was happening back home during the war. Do you have any specific impressions, or do you remember anything specific that, you know, would portray what was going on in America during the war?
I remember mixing yellow food coloring in with some sort of thing like cream cheese, so it looked like butter, and things like that. But I remember being very concerned. Well, my brother was gone, and my brother-in-law, and I was always very concerned about the Japanese being evacuated from the West Coast and brought to these camps in Colorado. And I thought, even at that time, I thought it was so unfair. And I think it was probably one of the worst dark days for our country when he, the president, decided to move all those people.
Were they evacuation camps, or
were they sent to these camps?
Or were they the? Do you know if they were evacuation or internment camps?
They were internment camps.
Really? That's really fascinating.
Yeah.
We have some. I remember the fathers. My wife's father, for example, they had to wear helmets, and they had, if you recall, night, because the United States was very vulnerable at that time, and the East Coast of the United States was particularly vulnerable. Audrey and I go to a place called Amagansett, Long Island, and there were many German submarines off the coast at that time, and the United States was, particularly on the East Coast, was very vulnerable. And so those who were civilians, for one reason or another, had to be on watch at home.
Thank you.
I can give a story to complete with that one. One of our, I wish he were here, distinguished members, he lives in Madison, Wisconsin. He is one of the foremost eye doctors in the country. Matthew Dinsdale Davis, right? And Dinsdale was there in the summer of 43. I took him to the shore for a weekend. He'd never been to the Jersey Shore. I don't think he'd been out of Madison, but anyway, until he came here. And he was a great photographer. He loved that, and he had a camera with him all the time. So we're on the Jersey Shore, and passing over one of the inlets was a Navy, I don't know whether it wasn't a bomber, but it was a Navy plane. And he decided, that's a great shot. Boing, he hit it. About a block away was a Coast Guard post, and they were really on the ball. They had spotted it, and 5 minutes later, a guy comes up in a Jeep and he said, "Hey, fellas, come here a minute." And he said, "One of you, I think, took a picture of that plane." And Matthew said, "Yes, I did." He said, "Well, let me have your camera, please." He takes the film out and gave him back the camera. He said, I'll return the pictures if they're okay." In a couple weeks, he got them back. But that's how alert they were at that point. And here's a gentleman from the class of 44 who learned a little lesson that day. But that was part of the start of our war experiences, was that day once in the summer of 42, 43.